Shabbos Daf Lamed contains a discussion about the Mishnah, which we just learned at the end of yesterday's Daf, about Machash and Atzicha Legufa and the Machlokes between Rav Shimon and Rabbi Yehuda. From there, we will launch into another question that was asked on the same subject, which will take us to a long drasha by Rabbi Tanchum, resolving a contradiction between three psukim, mostly in Sefer Koheles, about whether it is better to be alive or dead. This will take us to some more contradictions in Sefer Koheles as to whether joy is good for you or laughter is good. And then we'll discuss some contradictions in the book of Mishlei. In order to understand the Gemara's comments on the Mishnah, which ended off the daf yesterday, we need an introduction into the concept of Malachash and Etzricha Legufa. It's a concept we've discussed in the past. Malachash and Etzricha Legufa means you did a Malacha de Oraisa, but you did not do it for the purpose that is needed to violate the Isser de Oraisa, which is the purpose that Malacha was used for in the building of the Mishkan. So, for example, if you dug a hole, but not because you wanted a hole, you dug a hole because you wanted the dirt, so that's called Malachash and Etzricha Legufa. Now, what is the halacha of Malachash and Etzricha Legufa? Machlokes Rabbi Yehuda and Rabbi Shimon. According to Rabbi Yehuda, you violate the Isser D'oraisa anyway, it doesn't matter. According to Rabbi Shimon, however, it's only Aser D'rabbanan. Now, our mission discusses putting out a fire. Now, fires were put out in the construction of the Mishkan for constructive purposes, either to make coal or to make wicks. In order to make a functional wick, you had to scorch it and then put the fire out. Now, our Mishnah discusses a number of different reasons you may put a fire out and whether you violate an Isser D'oraisa or an Isser D'rabbanan. One of the things on the list of D'rabbanan was if you put it out in order that a sick person should be able to sleep. One of the things on the list for violating the Isser D'oraisa is if you put it out in order to make coal, which is Malacha Tzricha Legufa according to everybody. Also, if you put it out in order to save the candle because the lamp, the jug that the candle was in, it was about to crack. So now our Gemara says, well, our Mishnah apparently is holding like Rabbi Yehuda, because it says that if you put out the candle in order to save the jug from cracking, you're chayav d'oraisa. But that's Malachash and Etzricha Legufa. It must be Rabbi Yehuda's opinion. But if it's Rabbi Yehuda's opinion, so then how do you understand the fact that the Mishnah said that if you put it out in order that a sick person should be able to sleep, you don't violate an Isser d'oraisa? That seems to indicate that you do violate an Isser d'rabbanan. So I don't understand, the Gemara says. If it's talking about a sick person who is in a situation of life-threatening sickness, so then it should be a mitzvah to put it out. You should be allowed to. You shouldn't say that it's only Isser D'rabbanan. It doesn't make sense. I mean, we must be talking about somebody that's not that sick. And there is no mitzvah to do anything to save his life because his life is not in danger. So then I don't understand why you would be allowed to do it mi d'oraisa, and it's only Isser D'rabbanan. If we're in Rabbi Yehuda's opinion, the fact that it's a Malachash and Etzricha Legufa should not make it only D'rabbanan. It should say Isser D'oraisa. So the Gemara answers, the Gemara says, really we are talking about a person who is in a situation of grave threat to his life. And therefore you are allowed to put it out. There is no Isser D'oraisa to put the fire out, and rather he should be able to sleep. The only reason why it says that it's not an Isser D'oraisa, which seems to indicate that it is Isser D'rabbanan, even though that's not true, is in order that it should contrast evenly linguistically with the end of the Mishnah. The end of the Mishnah listed halachas which you are violating an Isser D'oraisa, so the beginning of the Mishnah said halachas which you're not violating an Isser D'oraisa. But you're really right. Not only is it not an Isser D'oraisa, it's not even an Isser D'rabbanan. The Gemara now asks, but hold on a second, I have a braisa which also talks about the case of putting out a light so that a sick person should be able to sleep, and this braisa clearly says that it's Isser D'rabbanan. So what would be the reason for that? You just told me that our Mishnah is really saying that it's mutter. Where it says, okay, this braisa is really Rav Shimon, and it's talking about a sick person who's in a non-life-threatening situation. The only reason it's permitted is because it's Malach Shana Tzricha Legufa, and it's Rav Shimon. But therefore, it's only permitted on the D'oraisa level. But Midrabanan, it is forbidden like all Malach Shana Tzricha Legufa. Gemara now says that the question of whether or not you're allowed to put out a candle so that a seriously ill person can sleep, that question was put before Rav Tanchum of Nevi as he was about to deliver a drasha. So Rav Tanchum first launched into his drasha, and then afterwards he addressed the question. Now the Gemara quotes Rav Tanchum's entire drasha. He was discussing three contradictory psukim about the subject of whether it is better to be alive or dead. Now the three psukim are as follows. One we have in Sefer Tehillim from David HaMelech. It says, "Le'hameisim yahaluka, the dead cannot praise Hashem." That seems to say that it's not good to be dead. But on the other hand, Shlomo HaMelech says, V'shabeach ani es ha'meisim m'shekvar meisu, that it's better off, I praise the dead that have already died, they are better off than the living who are still alive. And on the other hand, Shlomo Melech himself says that it's better to be a living dog than a dead lion. So Rav Tanchum says, Shlomo Melech, where's your wisdom? Where's your famous understanding? Not only do you contradict your father David, but you contradict yourself. So what Rav Tanchum will do is he'll say, first of all, the pasuk that we find in Tehillim, it says, Le'amesim yihalelu ka, that the dead are not good because they can't praise Hashem. That just means that a person who died cannot do mitzvahs anymore. In that respect, it's not good to be dead. He can't do mitzvahs. He cannot learn Torah. Rav Yechlin even quotes, it says, "B'meisim chavshi," the dead are free. It doesn't mean that the dead are free, that they don't have mitzvahs anymore. They don't have Torah. In that sense, being among the dead is a terrible thing. One can no longer bring honor to Hashem. What did Shlomo HaMelech mean when he said in Koheles, Shabbeach ani es ha'meisim, I praise the dead, they are better off than the living? So Rav Tanchum offers three explanations of this. The first explanation is that the dead have more influence than the living do, because if you look at what happened after the Chayta Egel, the sin of the golden calf, Moshe Rabbeinu stood and he prayed before HaKadosh Baruch Hu that he should forgive the Jewish people, and he said many tefillahs, and Hashem refused to listen to him. The only thing that Hashem listened to was when he said, "Zochar l'Avraham l'Yitzchak l'Yisrael avadacha." Remember the merit of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. So you see that the merit of the dead was able to bring relief from this avera, while Moshe himself was not able to. So in that sense, the dead are more powerful than the living. That's the first explanation. Now we have a second explanation, which is similar. Rav Tanchum says, rulers of the world, when they issue a rule, when they issue a decree, maybe the people will listen to them, maybe they won't. And even if they do listen to it, after he dies, they're certainly not going to listen to it. But Moshe Rabbeinu, he made many laws, and he transmitted to us many decrees, and they all still stand many thousands of years after he died. So, Shlomo Melech was right. The dead, meaning Moshe Rabbeinu, the generations earlier, their decrees still stand, but today's rulers, their decrees will not last very long. So in that sense, Moshe Rabbeinu is the dead, and he is better than modern kings. Now we have a third explanation as to what Shlomo HaMelech, when he said the dead are better off than the living. And this is a totally different subject. First of the following thing. After David HaMelech did what was construed as a mistake with Bas Sheva, he was together with her even though she was married to someone else, but her husband had gone off to war and he had given her a divorce already on condition that he doesn't come back from war, which he did not come back from. But still, even though it was not technically an avera because she was technically, she had a retroactive divorce, but he still suffered a lot from it, and it was considered to be a sin to some extent. People gave him a hard time, and he suffered physically because of it. So he asked Hashem to forgive him, and Hashem said, "You are forgiven." So David said, "Give me a sign that I'm forgiven." So he said, "You're not going to get a sign in your lifetime. You'll get a sign after your death. I'll make a public sign. Everybody will see that you are forgiven." This is how the dead are better than the living, because of this public sign that happened after the death of King David. Now the Gemara describes what actually happened. When Shlomo HaMelech built the Beis HaMikdash, so he was the son of David, who already was gone, he died. But what happened was, is when Shlomo wanted to inaugurate the Beis HaMikdash, the gates remained locked and closed, and he couldn't get them open to bring in the Kodesh HaKadoshim. So Shlomo sang 24 songs of prayer, and the gates remained locked. So he started to say tefillah. So he said, "Se'ur sharam Hashem, v'yinasu pischei olam, raise up your heads, gates be uplifted, everlasting entrances, v'yavai melech hakaveh, so the king of glory may enter." So the gates heard that, and they started running after him to swallow him up. They said, who do you think you are? You think you're the king of glory, achutzpah? So Shlomo said, "No, I'm not talking about me. It's Hashem Yizuz v'Gibor. Hashem Gibor Melchama. I'm referring to HaKadosh Baruch Hu." So the gates said, "All right, but still we're not opening." So Shlomo said, "Zu Sharam Hashem Uzu Pischei Olam V'Yavi Melech HaKavod. Raise up your heads, gates. Raise up everlasting entrances, and let the King of Glory come in." Me, who's that Melech HaKavod? And who, by the way, who's this King of Glory I'm referring to? Hashem Tzivakos Melech HaKavod Tzal. I'm referring to Hashem. After all that, the gates didn't listen. They remained locked. Oh, but then Shlomo said, "Hashem lekim al tashiv pnei mishichecha zocha lechazdei David avdecha. Don't turn away from your anointed one. Remember the tzidkas of David." Oh, then the gates opened, and all of Klaus over there, and all of the enemies of David HaMelech had their faces turned black like the bottom of a pot. because they saw clearly that the Beis HaMikdash was only opened in the merit of King David, and that he was forgiven for that aveira. And that's what Shlomo HaMelech meant when he said that the dead are better off than the living. Now the Gemara says we're going to discuss an allusion to this in the Psukim, which describe the inauguration ceremonies for Shlomo HaMelech. When he was inaugurated, it says as follows. It says, on the eighth day of the inauguration celebrations, he dismissed the people and they went home. They all went home to their houses happy, glad of heart. For all the goodness that Hashem had done for David, Avdai, his servant, Eliyashar, Amen, for all his people. So the Gemara says, what does all this mean? So the Gemara says, V'yechol aleim, they went home. That means that their wives were tohoros when they came home. Smechem, they were happy. That means that they had the ziv ha-shechina, the radiance of the shechina. Tov lev, they had glad heart. That means that each of their wives conceived then and gave birth to a baby boy. Alkal tevesha, also all the goodness. That means that the goodness that he did for David, that's referring to this, that he gave a sign that he forgave him for this avera, and Yisrael Amai, that's the fact that they ate on Yom Kippur, because the celebrations of the inauguration began before Yom Kippur and went through to Sukkot, and they had eaten on Yom Kippur. They weren't sure if it was the right thing to do, however, they got a sign that it was correct. Rav Tanchum continues, and he now explains the last of the three psukim, which said that it's better to be a live dog than a dead lion, which we had understood as a saying, even if you're a lowly animal, as long as you're alive, it's better than being a great mighty animal who is dead, meaning the living are always better off than the dead. And now Rav Tanchum explains that it really has nothing to do with that. It was talking about a halach and Hilchos Shabbos about muktzah. And the Gemara proceeds to relate what he's referring to. It's something that Rav Yehuda said in the name of Rav. And in order to understand this, we have to expound on a pasuk in the Tehillim, which says, "Haydeini Hashem Kitzi, Hashem, please reveal to me my end." Said David HaMelech, "Midas Yom Mahi, what is the length of my days? Eda Ma Chodel Ani, let me know when I will end." So the Gemara explains what this was. The Gemara says that David said to Hashem, "Baruch Shalai, the Master of the Universe, let me know how I'm going to die." He said to him, "No, there's a rule that a person may not know how he's going to die." So he said, "Umidas yomai mahi, but how long will I live?" Hashem said, "No, there is a rule that a person cannot know how long he's supposed to live." So he said, "Eidam machadalani," he said, "let me know at least what day of the week I'm going to die." So Hashem said, "Okay, you're going to die on Shabbos." Now, he wasn't happy about that, because on Shabbos he knows that he will become mukta. Once a person has died, his body is an object with no function. You can't use a dead human corpse for anything, so he'll become a muktzah, which means he'll be left outside, and he will not be able to be buried until after Shabbos. He'll have to stay out in the open for a long time. He wasn't happy about it. So he said, "You know what, Hashem, can I please die on the Sunday following that Shabbos that I'm supposed to die?" He said, "No, you can't, because Shlomo HaMelech, your son's reign is supposed to begin, and you can't have overlapping reign, even by a day." So David said, "Okay, so let me die at least Friday before." He said, "No, because your learning that you do, the Torah study, is worth more to me than all 1,000 karbanos that Shlomo HaMelech will bring. So I will not allow you to die earlier than you're supposed to." Well, and now at least that he knew that he was going to pass away on a Shabbos, so David tried to do something about it. And he resolved that he was going to learn every single Shabbos from beginning to end straight, without a single split second of stopping. And then the Melech HaMavis, the angel of death, would not be able to affect him, because he could not affect him while he's learning. So the day that he was supposed to pass away came, and the Melech HaMavis stood in front of him, and he couldn't find a way to get through to him, because he didn't stop learning for an instant. So he didn't know what to do. So he went out to the orchard behind the house, and he shook the trees. So David went to see what was happening, but he didn't stop learning. He was learning as he was walking. But then the stair, as he was walking up the steps, the stair caved in under him, and he fell. And for a split second, he stopped learning, and then the Melech HaMavis was able to get through to him, and then he died. So the Gemara says that when Shlomo HaMelech found out that his father had died, he sent two shailas, two questions to the Sanhedrin. First of all, he said, "My father has died and his body is in the sun." and it's mukta. So what could I do to move it or to protect it from decomposing until after Shabbos? You don't want it to become all kinds of things will happen to it. The second problem was that my father has some dogs, and the dogs no longer have any food. Am I allowed to feed them? They're not my dogs. So the Sanhedrin sent back as follows. He said, as far as the dogs, you're allowed to cut up a dead animal and feed it to the dogs, because an animal that died is not mukta. It has a function. It's dog food. And therefore, there's no problem with that. Now, your father who died, he is mukta. But because we want to prevent him from coming to a disgraceful situation, we have a leniency. You're allowed to place a non-mukta object, such as a loaf of bread or even a child, upon the body. And then you can carry the child and the bread, or the bread together with the body, into the shade. And that is a strategy which doesn't usually work, but in order to save the body from disgrace, we're allowed to do that. So on that, Shlomo Melech said, so you see, it's better to be a live dog than a dead lion, because in order to feed my father's dogs, I'm allowed to do whatever I want. There's no restrictions. But in order to move my father himself, because he died, there are all kinds of restrictions. I need a loaf of bread, or a child, or all these things. Okay, this concludes Rav Tanchum's drasha. And now Rav Tanchum addressed the question that they asked him, which was, are you allowed to put out a candle in order to save a person who is sick in a dangerous way? And he said as follows. He said, a person's soul is called a ner, it's called a candle, and an actual candle is really called a candle. It's better to put out a human candle, meaning the actual candle, than to put out Hashem's candle, which is the soul, and therefore it is correct to put the candle out. Okay, this concludes the discussion of Rav Tanchum. Now, the Gemara, on that note, talks about a number of other contradictions in Sefer Koheles, which is what Rav Tanchum was discussing. So the Gemara says that Rav Yehuda, the son of Rishol Bar Shilas, said that when the Chachamim really wanted to put the entire Sefer Koheles into Shemus, they wanted to get rid of it because it had a lot of contradictions. And they didn't, because the beginning of it has Divrei Torah and the end of it has Divrei Torah. The Gemara says, what does this mean? Where it says, well, it starts off and it says, what profit does man have from all his labor which he toils under the sun? It's only under the sun that he has no profit, but that which came before the sun, meaning Torah, which was created before the sun itself, that a person has tremendous profit from. That's the return in the beginning of the Sefer, and at the end of the Sefer it says, Saif Devar Kol Nishma, some of everything, when everything has been considered, fear God and keep his mitzvahs, for this is all of man. What does it mean, this is all of man? Three explanations. Rabbi Eliezer says the entire world is only created for the sake of the person who is God-fearing. Abar Kahana says the person who is God-fearing and keeps the mitzvahs is of equal importance to the entire world. And Shimon ben Azai says, and some say it was just Shimon ben Zayma, the entire world was only created to accompany this person who is God-fearing and performs mitzvahs. Now the Gemara discusses what the contradictions are in the Book of Koheles. And the Gemara says they concern the issue of laughter and they concern the issue of joy. About laughter, it says in one place, Taif kas mischaik is better, anger is better than laughter, and that shows that laughter is very bad. In the other place it says, Sushaik umarati mahula, I've said that laughter is praiseworthy. So Gemara says that's not a contradiction. One is talking about the anger that a Kadosh Baruch Hu shows towards tzaddikim to get rid of their averos, their few sins in this world. That's better than the laughter, meaning the joy, the laughter that the rishayim, the wicked, experience in this world in order that they get rewarded for their few mitzvahs in this world. So that is not a contradiction with that which it says, L'schaik amarati mehulol, that's referring to the laughter that Kadosh Baruch Hu laughs together with the tzaddikim in the world to come. So that's not a contradiction. The laughter of the Rishayim in this world is bad. The laughter of the Tzaddikim in the world to come, that's good. Not a contradiction at all. As far as joy, in one place it says, Shibachti ani es simcha. It says, I praise joy. That's referring to simcha shel mitzvah, the joy of doing a mitzvah. On the other hand, when it says, L'simcha mazai oiso, when it says joy, what does that do? That's referring to material joy, joy that's not associated with a mitzvah. That's a bad thing. In a sense, therefore, the resolution of the two contradictions are very similar. The Gemara now discusses a little bit about the benefits of joy. The Gemara says that the Shekhinah does not rest upon a Navi in a state of sadness, not in a state of laziness, not in a state of laughter, not in a state of lightheadedness, not in a state of idle chatter, not through idle conversations. It only comes through Simcha Shel Mitzvah, the joy of doing a mitzvah. Like it says, Va'atukhuli ha-menagin, bring me a musician, va'ikenagin ha-menagin, va'tiyolav yad Hashem. And when there was a musician was playing, so God rested his presence upon Elisha the Navi. Now the Gemara says more. Rav Yehuda says, you should learn halacha in a state of joy. And Rava says, if you want to have a good dream, you should go to sleep in a state of joy. Then he says, hold on a second, you're really supposed to learn in a state of joy, but Rav Gidol said the name of Rav, a Talmud Chacham who sits before his teacher has to be in a state of dread. His lips should be bitter, dripping, bitter dread. Otherwise, he'll end up in Gehenna. Like it says in the Pasuk, Sif Saisav, Sheshanem, Noitveis Mar Oiver. And that translates to, his lips are like roses dripping, flowing myrrh. But we reread Moyer Oiver as Mar Oiver, and we reread Shoshanim, meaning roses, we reread that as Sheshanim, people learning. And now it reads that the lips of people learning are dripping bitterness, because you should be in a very serious mood when you're learning Torah, not a state of joy. Versus no, it's not a contradiction. One is talking about the teacher, one is talking about the student. The student should be in a state of awe of his teacher, while the teacher should be in a state of joy and should give over the teachings with joy. Or the Gemara says the second answer. One is talking about before you start, one is talking about once you start. Like Rabbah always used to start off with a joke before he started the shir in order to open up the students' minds, and then afterwards he would sit with tremendous awe and trepidation during the shir. Okay, now the Gemara says, we've discussed the Sefer Kohelis that they wanted to get rid of it, to put it in Geniza, in a Sheamus. The same thing actually happened to the book of Mishlei. Now, why did they not get rid of the book of Mishlei? They said, well, when we were trying to get rid of Kohelis, we hadn't learned through it carefully, and when we learned through it carefully, we found the resolutions to its contradictions. So let's try to find the resolutions to the contradictions in Mishlei. The Gemara now says, what are the contradictions in Sefer Mishlei? The Gemara says it's referring to whether or not you should answer a fool. In one place it says, Al ta'an ksil ki valta, don't bother answering a fool, you just get sucked into an argument that you can't win. And the other place it says, Anei ksil ki valta, you should answer a fool in his foolishness. So, which is it? So the Gemara says it depends. If it's about Torah, you should answer him, because you don't want him to think that he's proved his point and that he's right, because then he'll end up making a terrible mistake and teaching it to others. But if it's about other subjects, matters of the world, don't bother answering him. You have nothing to gain by lending credence to his position by even discussing it. Now the Gemara proves these things with three examples of each. First of all, three examples of not answering a fool. The Gemara says that a person came to Rebbe and he said, you know, your wife is my wife, meaning I was with her illegitimately, and your children are really my children. Oh, Rebbe didn't bother answering him. He said, would you like a glass of wine? So the person drank the glass of wine, and he exploded. Then a person came to Rebbe Chia. According to some, this is actually Rebbe, and he said, your mother is actually my wife. I was together with her, and you are my illegitimate child. And Rebbe Chia said, would you like a glass of wine? He took the wine, and he exploded. Now the Gemara explains why Rebbe was saved from this. If this person would have been trusted or believed by anybody, his children or he himself would have been viewed as a mamzer, as an illegitimate child. And said, because he said a tefillah every day, save me Hashem, yirasim b'fanecha Hashem, lekenu shetatzileni ayoyim b'vichoyim me'azui funim u'me'azus ponim. Save me from rude people and from rudeness. That's rude people. This refers to mamzerim, who have the midah of rudeness, and from he himself being considered to be a mamzer. Now, how do we have examples, three examples of you should argue with a fool in matters of Torah? So the Gemara brings three things that Rabbi Gamliel said that will happen in days of Mashiach. Rabbi Gamliel said, in days of Mashiach, a woman will be able to have a child from a new pregnancy each and every day, because she will be able to have overlapping pregnancies, and therefore they can each end day by day by day. So somebody heard him say that, and he said, that's ridiculous. Nothing new will ever happen. It can't happen. So Rabbi Gamliel said, I'll show it to you. Look at a chicken. Lays a new egg every day. And obviously, each one is being developed while the other one is being born. Another thing, Rabbi Gamliel said, in the days of Mashiach, the trees will bear new fruits every day. Like it says, Venasa onafa asaferi, it'll bring forth branches and fruit. So, a Talmud said, what are you talking about? Can't be such a thing. Nothing new under the sun. Rabbi Gamliel said, I'll show you. There's a tree that even does that today. And he showed him the tzlaf, the caper plant, which is the plants that grow out of the walls of the kosel, and they have edible fruits, flowers, and shoots. and they grow one after the other. And then another thing, Rav Gamliel said, in the days of Mashiach, the soil will grow ready-made bread and ready-made clothing. Like it says, Yehi pisas bar ba'aretz. Pisas refers to striped, refers to ready-made clothing, and bar means food. So the Gemara again says that somebody made fun of him. He said, can't be. There's never anything new under the sun. Rav Gamliel said, I'll show it to you. It even happens today. And he showed him that there is mushrooms that grow in a bread roll type of shape. And they can grow in one night. And they're ready to eat. As far as clothing, he showed him a young palm tree that has a layer of cloth that grows over the heart of the tree. And that can be used for cloth right away.